your family is under God, and we will praise the name of the Lord.
Welcome to this program, Families Under God. What a joy to have you, and thank you for all of you that have written to say that you were blessed by Angela's testimony. You know, the good news is that we are going to continue with it. But before we continue, I want you to know that we meet here on Cabaronet Gardens every Thursday, 12:30 to 2:30. Come and you hear other testimonies and you see God at work. Would you believe it? Right now we have 9 students at different universities. The little children we picked from Kibera and started educating, they are already in different universities. And right now we are paying school fees for 170 children. And you know you could be part of that. So there is a lot that you can hear when you come here. And so I invite you every Thursday, 12:30, to 2:30. But for now, we want to continue with Angela's testimony. Angela, thank you once again for agreeing to finish your testimony for us. Yes, but before we stopped last week and the prayer that you prayed, which was very, very powerful, you talked about these addictions, that they are different addictions, and that God delivers from addictions. Can we start from there, the different addictions?
Well, God delivers, because there was, for me, there was drinking, there was smoking. There are people who are struggling with pornography or with sexual sin, and they don't know how to stop.
Yeah.
And they just keep doing it, and they keep getting it. It becomes darker and darker and darker. But there's no addiction that God cannot cannot deliver from. And you see, some addictions can be seen, but some cannot be seen. There are even people who are functioning alcoholics. They drink alcohol, but they function in every way. Nobody will need to know that. But when some addictions are obvious, like maybe if you're addicted to food or something, it will be obvious. So God, there's nothing that God cannot do. You have to keep crying to him. Because you know what I used to do? Imagine, I even used to fast.
That's what you said in your prayer.
I used to fast.
That you would fast, that you stop drinking and smoking.
And smoking, and it wouldn't.
And you still continue.
Yeah. And when I would smoke, I would cry.
Oh.
I would cry. Because even remember, the alcohol went first. So the alcohol addiction went, and I was no longer addicted to the alcohol.
Yeah.
But the smoking took time. So I would say, I want to stop this. I would cry and tell God to stop. And you know, even with my daughter and other people who I meet, I tell them, never smoke. I think it's the worst addiction. Because that one, and maybe pornography. I didn't engage in pornography, but I've heard people say how it's such a struggle
to stop.
So there are some things that even alcohol, don't start. Because you don't even know whether you're going to be addicted.
Yes.
I used to say, you know, you might disappear inside the bottle. And we don't know. So there are some of these things that are not necessary to start, you know, because they cause problems. So like now, when I wanted to try, like now even the place I used to smoke, I didn't go there for 7 days. I never went there again. And it took 7 days for the whole thing to be broken. So I was also prayed for. Actually, now I didn't tell you about that. I was at a retreat, a prayer retreat. A prayer retreat. Pastor Simon, we used to have these retreats. They were up somewhere. We were somewhere near Masai Lodge. I can't remember. And it was some people who had made a retreat, just like you have a retreat center, which is a very good thing. So they have this retreat center. I think they were either from Europe or somewhere. So we'd go there for a prayer retreat. So when I went there for the prayer retreat, you won't even believe this. I don't think I've ever even shared this. I was looking for a place to smoke. That is how I'm at a prayer retreat. But I'm looking for a place where I can go and hide and smoke, and I can't find any. Just there, when I'm looking for a place to go and smoke, I'm called forward, and I was prayed for by Pastor Simon and Pastor Linda, and they prayed for me, which what I understand now was my commissioning, because I understand how prayer is my gift and that's what I'm meant to do. So they commissioned me with Isaiah 56, verse 7. That my house shall be called the house of prayer and a joy for all nations. So there, me, I'm looking for a place to smoke. God is looking for me. So do you know, I never smoked again after that, by the way. Actually, every time I would be prayed for to stop smoking, and smoking at that time, I would bring my cigarettes to the person who has prayed for me.
For you.
This time, I brought the cigarettes and the lighter. I knew it was done. I bought the cigarettes and the lighter. I was even laughing with that.
Why would you keep the lighter?
Going to buy another packet.
Oh, you knew you were going
to buy. I knew it's not done. But for me, this was the confirmation that this was done.
Amen.
Was I surrendered the lighter and the cigarettes. And
thank
that was
you,
it.
Jesus.
And I remember Pastor Simon telling me, 7 days, first of all, do not go anywhere. And it's true. I would count, like your friend, you're saying your friend, the one who her husband was telling her. So me, I waited. I never opened that door again. The door where I used to smoke, even at home, I didn't open it again, and it was done. And it was the most amazing thing.
Amen.
At a prayer retreat. As a matter of fact, I went to see my doctor. Because my doctor had been telling me, you have to stop smoking, you have to stop drinking. So when I did, I went to tell him, oh, by the way, I stopped smoking. Then he asked me how. So I told him, at a prayer retreat. Then he asked me, do you expect me to write that in the file? I said, but you have been telling me to stop smoking, I've not stopped.
Yes.
But when I went to the prayer retreat, I stopped. So please, can you put it
write
on record?
It there.
Yes.
For
write
record
that,
purposes.
Because you've been telling me, and it's not happened.
Tell me, at this point, are you divorced yet?
Now I can't remember. Am I divorced yet? You know, I always get confused.
I
got, my husband left 2001. So when he left, I went into a drunken stupor for 2 years.
Yes.
Completely functioning. But I was very concerned about my daughter. So I guess I had sufficient training. So I'd even be home, let her sleep, then I do my drinking now when she's asleep. So, but I just went into like a stupor. All I wanted to do was drink.
Yeah.
And get drunk
just
and
forget.
Club and just forget. But then that's how now, then I started going to that church.
Yes.
Then now the pastor talked. So I started coming out of that thing. And then now, when I because I knew God now, so my husband walked out in 2001. So 2004 is when I gave my life to Christ. That's like 3 years later.
Yeah.
Then I got divorced in 2008. Because all this time, like now, if I think from 2003, I'm trying to figure out, the Bible says God hates divorce. I'm telling God, my husband has already cost me a lot. He can't cost me salvation and my destiny. Me, I need to spend eternity with you.
Yes.
So it took me a long time, I think almost 5 years of serious prayer and fasting and asking God for a sign.
Yeah.
Asking for reconciliation. Speaking to him about reconciliation, but no reconciliation was forthcoming. And really praying, being serious, really praying, really fasting, having other people stand with me in prayer. Like, if this is the will of God, please let it come back. Because but for me, I kept looking at that scripture of God
hates divorce.
God hates
Malachi,
divorce. Yeah. And it really used to disturb me. And I used to say, you know, now what do I do now? But around, I think, 2008, I felt a breakthrough. I felt like I'd been praying for this for like 4 years.
Yes.
So I felt like I had prayed, I had fasted, I had done my time, and I'd looked at where God said it's not his perfect will. You see, because he says it was not so in the beginning. In Matthew, when they asked him, why did he allow for divorce? He said it was not so in the beginning. That's not what his
expectation
was.
But it was because of the hardness of the heart of man.
So now I felt that I had prayed, and I felt I needed now that release. It's strange because I don't know how to say this, Reverend Judy, but I don't believe in divorce. I really don't. And I've done my best to encourage as many people to stay together. I've given testimonies in church. I've talked about it, and I've talked at the end of it. It sounds like an oxymoron, but I don't believe in divorce.
Yes.
I believe that divorce really destroys families and really destroys children.
Yes.
And it is a mark on your children that is very hard to remove. So even with me and my ex-husband, we decided to be very intentional and very deliberate on our interaction and how we're going to bring up our child. And therefore, I still feel she has pain, but it has been, we've cushioned the blow.
Yes.
So me and him, we work, whatever is good for the child,
do it together.
Whatever
that is,
we don't fight about each other, we don't insult each other, we don't talk negatively about each other. We agreed that we had messed up, but this child, we were going to do the best for that child. Because I feel very sad when parents begin to fight. You know, you confuse the child.
Yes.
The child loves both of you. The child does not even know which one to choose.
And
who the
know
child choose
which side
he doesn't
take.
Know what happened. You know, and you cause that child a lot of pain, a lot of anguish.
Yes.
And then you people even worse, they even start playing with the children. You start using the children. If you want to, if you don't give us money, you won't see the children. You start doing all sorts of crazy things that are affecting the child negatively.
Yes.
You can't do that. You must do what is right for your children.
The
two of you, and you can't use the children as a pawn. You can't use the children as a weapon. You can't use the children as a way to get solutions.
Yes.
You can't use the children to punish.
No,
because it
shouldn't.
Will catch up with you.
You shouldn't.
Like,
you
I have shouldn't. People, because I counsel a lot of people. I think for me, in terms of divorce and things like that, the one that scares me is a lady who had 4 sons, and she refused the 4 sons to see the father, and she lied about them. The problem is we forget children are growing. When they grow up, do you know now, none of those children talk to the mother.
Talks to the mother.
They all went and looked for the father and have sided with the father.
Ah.
Oh, it's so tragic. You didn't have to do that. You shouldn't have lied. You should let the children see their father because he's their father. It's not about whether he's providing, not you know, all those things we add. That's not it.
Yeah.
Because also the wound of, you know, when I think about you're adding a value, saying this person has to pay school fees or buy food, but you're injuring a human being. You're injuring a spirit in a way that it will be beyond repair. It should not be about whether they ate.
Yes.
Ask God to provide for you.
Yes.
To provide for your children.
Yes.
But don't use your children as a weapon because your children will hurt.
And they, when they hurt, they will always remember it.
And it's so hard to heal from that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they already have a lot to heal from the fact that your two are not together. Because every child, even right now, my daughter still, if you asked her, her prayer would be for her, her parents to come back together. Yes. Every child wants their parents
together.
So if the circumstance is not like that, then you have to do everything in your power to make it easier for them. You must make it gentler. You must behave like mature people because you of the effects and the impact on the child.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. It's so good to hear that from you, Angela, because you're talking about your testimony, somebody who has gone through it.
Oh.
But since then, I understand that you are helping many, many hurting women
very
in this area. So
God,
what is the
men.
Ministry? What is the ministry that you are doing? And how can people connect with that ministry?
Wow, I have many ministries. I think I'll start with the first one, which is the easiest, which I love God because of his, of his. You know, God says, I know the age that is coming. So we're in a technological age. So the first one I'll start with is I have a platform called Just Angie. So Just Angie is on Facebook and on YouTube. And every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday, I share a video. Why that is important is because these days people are very private. So the best thing with the video, it comes on your phone or your laptop, so you can watch it in your
bedroom,
privacy,
wherever
you want to watch it, and nobody else needs to know that you watched it. So that's a good way to engage with God. So and there's a video shared on Sunday, on Monday, and on Thursdays. So that's very important, so that we just begin to engage and have conversations that are guiding us to light and to life and to God. And they're engaging conversations. Then I have a ministry called Jacob's Well, which is a ministry that reconciles families back to God. So in that Jacob's Well, we have a every near International Women's Day, we have an event called Family Talk. So we have an event around International Women's Day, and we have an event around Father's Day in June. So the Father's Day is around men, and the Women's Day is around women. And we just recognize women who are impacting the society differently, and we have conversations with them. Like this next year, we're going to have, there's a lady who shared her article about her divorce, her marriage, her workplace, and the pressure of all that, I think called Carol Wanena. So she'll be there next year, you know? So we just want to talk to women, realness, real women, you know, because we don't want to be fake. Want to be real. These are the pressures of life. What is taking place in your life? How are you tackling the issues of life? How are you helping other people do different things in society? So we have that conversation around around all issues around marriage. And then we have something called Unpacking Marriage Retreat. Every October, we have an Unpacking Marriage Retreat. And if you call the number 0705-737373, 0705 737373, there'll always be somebody to ask, you can ask about all the events that we have. So we have these events around women, and then we have something called speaker series. So we come and we just talk, we engage conversations about unpacking marriage. And then even within the ministry, there are people who have evolved in the ministry and grown, because I told you I run a leadership program. So there are people who have also started their own ministries as an offshoot. So there's a lady called Waithera who does something called Widmead. When I do means I don't. So she's also started a ministry, and she's having event. I think she's having one in November and one in next year as well. So they can find out all this information from us. We have a website because we run a, so under all this, we do Kingdom Business Solutions, which runs a program called the Purpose and Leadership Forum. That's my signature program. That's my main program, which happens over
Purpose and Leadership
Forum. So God downloaded, I have a manual which I've written, and it's on audio and on print. And we're even thinking of putting it online.
Okay.
So that it's
available
online.
Where do all these trainings take place?
They take place in Karen.
Meetings.
Trainings and meetings and events. They take place in Karen. I'm on the Karen Road. It's called the Joseph's House. That's why it's important to ask for the number I've shared. You can go to that. You can even go to our website, www.kingdombusinesssolutions.org. We also do coaching. We have a whole coaching center with 12 coaches. So if you go to that website, you'll see the coaches. Then you, because a coach, you have to connect. So you can pick the coach that you want, and we can begin a journey. So we do counseling, we coach, we mentor, we train on leadership, we pray. So every first 2 Mondays of the month, we have a fellowship where we pray, we gather, we pray, and we praise. Yeah, so that's, it's a very big, vibrant community.
Have
that
you
we're doing
found
this.
any solutions? Have you helped any people that have come out with a testimony?
Oh, very
that
many
you are
people.
Dying.
Very many people have come out with testimonies. Yeah, marriages that have been reconciled. The lady I told you who started a ministry right there for Weedmead, she had left her husband for 4 years.
Oh,
her and husband had been separated. So through a lot of mentorship, prayer, counseling, we managed to, by the grace of God, they got back together. They actually, that time I had my office on Riara Road, they actually had their renewal ceremony in the compound, and they are very their sons in the house now. So they're really avid. So that's how that ministry, imagine 4 years, they got back together, they have another child, a girl, and then they started this ministry called Weedmead. So they're also counseling people, talking to people,
the Lord.
Having difficult conversations around marriage. You know, the conversations that are not normally talked about. And it's not Angie who transforms. It's the Holy Spirit and the materials they're engaging with that transforms people. Then when you're transformed, when you're settled in life, I feel like a lot of the testimonies, people get direction. Because we teach you who you are spiritually. It's a faith-based program. So we teach you who you are, how to pray, what kind of lifestyle you need as a Christian. We find out, we show you what is your purpose in the marketplace. Because you see, when Jesus came, he didn't go to the church. He went to the his disciples were from the marketplace. And then he taught them until they spread the word of Christianity. That's what I feel PLF does. It you come, you learn, you engage. It's actually very good even for people who have been Christians for a long time. Because they seem to say, hey, why did we miss these lessons? The lessons come alive. Who you are becomes alive. What is your purpose on this earth? What is your purpose of your family? What's the purpose of your marriage? What is your purpose in the marketplace, in the nation that God has brought you? What are you doing every
what
day?
What are you doing? What impact
is changing
are you causing?
Every day. And it reminds me of Nehemiah. Because you see Nehemiah, it says everybody built near their house, but they had a weapon in one hand and they were working with the other.
With the other.
But they rebuilt the wall in a record
52 days and so, they were done.
So the outcome of PLF is that where you are with what God has given you, what are you doing to build his kingdom? What are you doing to advance his kingdom? What are you doing to establish his kingdom? I had another testimony. There's another group of people who, from a very, one of the, like, I think the top three brands in the nation company, they started a prayer group, a fellowship, which I still continue to run with them every first Wednesday of the month. We meet at Crown Plaza. So if you come and look for Marketplace Leaders Fellowship, you'll find us there. There's a young man who passed on in India. And in his eulogy, he wrote, who comes to work to get saved? But he came to work, and because this fellowship was there, this fellowship of leaders, very professional marketplace leaders, got to pray and to witness to him Christ. He got born again. So when he passed on, it's really sad because his life, he went too soon, but at least he went born again.
Praise the Lord.
He
Isn't
went
that
born
something?
Again. So I there are those so, kind of testimonies.
I am so excited, Angela, because as I look at you and know your parents, and know that you could just sit home and continue drinking and say that you get something. I also know you are the firstborn in the family. I know your daddy loved you so much. I'm sure he still loves you, and your mom. I know they can just, I mean, you can just sit there and just wait for them to go to heaven, and then you can sell the property that they will leave you with, and in the meantime you have something to drink. Please, there is a cry from parents that their children, there are so many children that are in that category. They don't want to work, and yet I was interviewing somebody called Mr. John Nganga, And he spoke that work is healthy, work is godly.
It's godly,
work is of God, and he's encouraging people to work. Mm. As we are just about to wind up this program, how would you like to encourage your young people, especially even those who have come up from well-to-do families like yours, that you don't just sit there and wait for your parents to go, but you make sure that whether you are born again or not born again, there is something you are doing to get an income for yourself.
We have to. I think the first thing is to understand that everybody was created with a purpose. I think that's the thing. So your parents had a purpose. They came together. I'm also feeling that they invested in you.
Yes,
they invested
a lot.
In us. They educated us, took us to the best schools, gave us everything that they possibly could. You can't be such a disappointment. You have to get up and to try. And then comparison is what is killing our children. They want to compare. They want, if this one got a salary like this, even me, I want. You have to do what is good for you.
Yes.
And you see, the Bible even says, if you don't work, you don't eat. It actually says that, you know. And stop looking to your parents' wealth.
Yes.
You need to make your own mark, your own statement in the world. And there should be motivation, because especially millennials, they are motivated because they want to have purpose.
Yes.
So you must have purpose. You must be motivated to make an impact.
Yes.
And you must be motivated to make this better.
Yes.
It also reminds me of the parable of the talents. One was given five, one was given two, one was given one.
Mm-hmm.
But the two and the five, they multiplied their talent.
Mm.
So we've been given a lot by our parents. We can sit back. It wouldn't be right to sit back and do nothing.
Yes.
But we have to do something because we have to multiply what they gave us.
Mm.
And then for me, I'm always looking at how am I going to impact the next generation, which is now my daughter. I want her to do even better and
even
go
better.
Even further. So if I stop, then I stop her also from making it. You know, I'm always saying the other thing is modeling.
Yes.
You know, that if if you model to your children strength, they will have strength. If you model weakness, they will be weak. So you have to model strength.
Yes.
You have to force people. You know, because I'm thinking, even for us, mom, if we were not forced to come to those prayers, I wouldn't be sitting here.
No, you wouldn't. You wouldn't.
So there's an element where parents also, depending on where the child is, at a younger age, you have to just force them. There's not, prayer is not a choice. Going to church is not a choice. So you force these things in them, you inculcate into them so that they, you see, I remember even, it's so funny, mom, when I was in school in Leeds, imagine I was, my parents were so far, but just because of that habit, which I hated, I didn't even want to go to church, but I would look
when
for a
church.
UK. Yes. Every Sunday morning, habit, modeled. I'm so far, I can sleep. My mom will not know I slept and I didn't go to church.
Yes.
I would wake up
and go to church.
And you know, the church even that time, even in Europe, was dying the way it is dying now. Do you know, there would be six people in church, geriatrics, they were 78, but I would be the seventh person.
Imagine
whether there was winter,
because something had
snow,
been inculcated.
Can you imagine
in you?
Whether it is raining, whether there is snow? I am either walking to church or taking a bus to church.
Yes.
But every Sunday I would be there. So we have to inculcate in our children what you want to see them become.
Amen.
And then I think even my dad helped, and I'm sure even your gen, my dad would say his money is his.
Yes.
Yeah. It is not ours. So everyone should look for their own money, which is a good thing, because it keeps you.
Yes.
It keeps you alive. You're like, hey, yeah, let me look for mine.
Yes.
Because this, I can't rely on that.
And he's been working hard.
Even
when he got the accident, he's still working very hard.
Yeah.
So he can work all that hard. And then he leaves everything for you to just waste. Angela, I wish we had time to talk more, because I know after this, there'll be so many questions. But the good thing is that this is not the last.
No.
This is the beginning.
Yes,
because for me, I want to say again, I'm personally very encouraged that prayer is never wasted. Those boardroom prayers,
were never wasted.
Praying for a boss, and at that point, not born again. But I can see what has happened.
Yeah.
And I'm not the only one who was praying, but I thank God
that
I can say I'm one of them. And once again, there are those people who are just sitting there and like you are wondering, how can I get to know the Lord Jesus Christ? Would you tell them how to know the Lord Jesus Christ and pray a very short prayer, because our time is over?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I think to know Jesus Christ, you just need to want to. Yeah.
Mm.
It gets to a point where actually maybe you're pushed in a corner, or sometimes they say you're between a rock and a hard place, or if you've reached rock bottom, it's a very important place to just say, I give up now. I surrender, God, and I always tell, you've tried everything else.
Yes.
Try Jesus.
Yes.
You've tried so many things and they're not working.
They are not
You're not
working.
Getting peace.
Yes.
You don't have peace. You don't have joy. You're not seeing anything working. Then you have to try God. Not that God is not a magician. But the one thing I love about salvation is the peace. there is so much peace. You sleep at night.
Yes.
There is peace. Yes. You know that God has it. I'm not saying that God solves all issues all times.
Yes.
Because even him is like a father. He has to take us through process.
Yes.
My father cannot solve all my problems. He needs me to exercise what he has taught me and what he has put in me to become what I need
what
to become.
You need
so
to
he
become.
Cannot give me. If he hands me over every time, he'll ruin me. Which is the same thing with God as a father.
Yeah.
God cannot just keep giving you. So we're not saying salvation is to come here and to be given, and everything works out well. But you have so much peace. You know that God is at work. You know that God loves you. And you know that God is working with you. And for me, the greatest gift of salvation is peace and joy. Because the Bible says it is righteousness, peace, and the joy of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. But there's a joy and a peace that nothing else can bring. And that's why even people will have lots of money but commit suicide.
Yes.
Yet other people are running after this money, and we think that when we have money, we'll be happy.
Yes.
But when you have it, you realize it will not
give
you happiness.
It's not
so
everything.
So salvation is to give you a centering and to give you peace and joy, and for your spirit to make peace with your maker.
Amen.
Because I believe salvation is reconnecting with God.
Amen.
Yeah, because disconnection came when Adam was in the garden.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
So reconnect. For me, salvation is reconnecting
with God.
With God.
Amen.
You're reconnecting your spirit, your life, your family, your purpose, your vision, your resources, everything about you
with
God.
Amen. 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 So would you please pray for those that are seeking salvation?
Yes. Heavenly Father, I just want to pray for every person that is listening to this, Lord, and they are seeking salvation, Lord. You are the Savior, Lord. And you know, even when they do movies, every movie has a Savior, has a big person who is supposed to save people. But in the reality that you are the Savior, Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world because he paid the price for us. So I pray that, Father, there are so many things we have tried. People have tried alcohol, they've tried drugs, they've tried pornography, they've tried sex, they've tried food, they've tried everything, but it's not satisfying, Lord. They've even tried going and making a lot of money, but it's still leaves them very empty, Lord. So I pray that, Father, you will cause people to try you, to try Jesus, and to try that way. And I just want to say, if you're out there and you want to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, please say after me, Lord Jesus Christ, I ask you this day to be Lord and Savior of my life. I ask you to come into my life. I surrender my life to you. And I ask you to occupy my life. Every space and every facet of my life. Spiritually, solically, physically, socially, financially, professionally, in leadership and in governance. Be my Lord and my Savior. I submit myself to the authority of Jesus Christ this day. And I decree that I am yours, and I will follow you. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
And if
Amen.
You did that, they
Amen.
Should follow, go to a good Bible-believing church, and begin to grow in the Word of God. And even come on Thursday to Ladies' Home Care and Cabernet Gardens, because it's a place, because I'm sitting here because prayer changed my life.
Prayer changes things. Amen.
That's not just something we're saying. Prayer, I am a living
it is with true.
Testimony.
Yes.
That prayer changes things.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for
and
having me.
And you can call us on the numbers on the screen, and we will be able to help you. Or call your pastor or whoever that you know, they love God. And Angela has not finished. This was just an introduction. There is so much.
Hi, my name is Fred Mohair. I have visited the Karen Home Care Retreat Center. I really loved it. The services are very professional. The reception is warm. The place is very calm and peaceful. The rooms are beautiful, well laid out and convenient. I was lucky to be served a meal and very cozy service, and I really enjoyed it. Most of all, it's a place that is was a blessing to me. And I really enjoy the time of reflection and enjoying just God's grace. The gardens are vast, the place is wide, you can walk, you can sit, you can have a place where you just reflect on the love of God in your life. I'll recommend this for anybody who wants to go and just have a peaceful time with his Lord.